Let me just say what I can say. Let me just say what I can say. Alright, we've got it rolling now. We've got it rolling. It's technology, you know, you just have to be patient and stay confident and don't let anything throw you. Just kind of like the culture of the world right now, right? Tremendous day. I believe it's July 11, 2016. Massive amount of breakthroughs. Plus, you know, long work day. Then I did a tremendous, tremendous workout. Unbelievable workout for the lower body, the legs. And tremendous amount of involvement with spiritual teaching, the Dharma, the gospel. And now the taping here. And wonderful comments coming in. It's just very auspicious time right now for those who want to get after it. And why not get after it right now? We're headed for whatever you want to call it. We don't have to call it anything, do we? We kind of know. So what we're headed for here is readiness. We're really ready. First to hit the parking lot, wave to the man in blue. Yeah. Wave to the man in blue. Who's the man in blue? Our mind, our true nature of mind, which is the only nature there is. So I'm having more and more glimpses of as it is, as it isness, you might say, as it isness, which is really right here. Everything is as it isness, actually. We're all bodhisattvas wandering about. Some are entertaining conventions of being, not being bodhisattvas, but we still are, you see. And this is as it isness. Now, let's just hit the ground running. Okay, now, well, I'll tell you what happened today. I was driving along the street, singing to the Beach Boys, and suddenly, with, of course, no warning whatsoever, a very large, fairly large, I would say, male deer with those antlers and all, leapt out of a hedgerow, and this is a suburban street. Leapt out of this hedge, right in front of my vehicle, super close. I said, "Oh my gosh, this is it! I'm going to hit a deer." So I just calmly, you know, slammed on the brakes, and waited for the impact, which never happened. Somehow the deer didn't get hit, and I maintained my perfect record throughout life of never hitting an animal. Never hitting anything while driving. There have been many squirrels that have been quite fortunate. I'll tell you, hundreds of squirrels, thousands. They're always dashing. I always try to look for squirrels. Oh, let me stop. Let me slow down. You know, let me don't run over anything. But don't swerve. That's what caused my cousin's death, was swerving. So I just braked and braked for impact. Never swerve when an animal leaps out. Just break, you know, it's unfortunate, right? But you don't want to lose your life like my cousin did. That's a great tragedy, to say the least. So this happened, and I was shaking after that. You drive along, and then suddenly right in front of you is this deer. I said, "What in the world? Why?" Well, very archetypal sort of situation, isn't it? Say the least. I know it is. What it means and all, well, I can speculate. So I'm just wondering how everyone is doing out there. What kind of archetypal situations are happening with you? Again, praying to the Nyingma masters, the Nyingma lineage. Great lineage. Praying to Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, maybe the most accomplished of all Buddhists that we know of, in terms of, since he wrote it down, all the empowerments, all the visions, everything. He saw everything as just intrinsic purity. So It's kind of like kind of scary reading his some of his stuff because you say, "Oh my gosh, what am I? Who am I to have his attention?" It's like what? But he has his reasons, and one of them that he showed me, I was asking him, "What's this about? What can I do to help you? You want me to, there's a connection. You made a connection, so." That's because you want to, you have some role, some work, something, you don't do that connection for no reason. That I can, that I can imagine. I wouldn't, or, maybe just an empowerment, but probably based on connections with Longchenpa, et cetera. Yeah, there's something going on. I would say, is there something going on? What's going on here? Then I saw something that's very unusual. The symbol that I've often seen symbolizes Tibetan Buddhists in various archetypal ways is those orange construction cones. They look like the hats that Jamyang wears. Actually, Jamyang. It's pronounced Jamyang. Yang is Yang, not Yang. Kind of a soft Yang. Not Yang, but Jamyang. Jamyang. So I said I'm driving. Suddenly I see this construction cone that got knocked over and was missing its top. And I don't think I've ever seen that before. It was so weird. I just said, "What?" And right away, I noticed. I said, "Ah, it's as I suspected. His aim, of course, is to preserve and enhance the Dharma, which is the gospel, the good news." Same term, gospel and dharma really mean the same thing. The good news, really good news. It's really just good news that they have to tell us. And he wants that to flourish. And he was the one that said it's unfortunately the system that we have, culture of Tibet, it's dying, and the dharma will spread west and it'll be more individualized, etc. He was aware of all of this, what's happening right now, very much aware of it. So he's very keen on what's going on right now with the good news in the world. And what I saw, what I suspect is that some of the Tibetans are having troubles. Some sort of troubles are starting to arise in them as the shock of leaving Tibet and their culture, and as it starts, the Tulku system starts to generating and everything starts to crumble. That they're starting to miss the apex approach. The top of the cone was gone. In other words, the apex approach is being lost. And this is the all-important approach that Longchenpa most beautifully and coherently expounded for us, which is what I subscribe to. And this is the great Nyingma tradition, the apex approach. So now, I just read a brief biography of Jamyang, and some monastery that he went to, I can't remember what it is, Kathak or something, Katok, Kathak or something, a very famous monastery in Tibet that had crumbled and fallen into just disrepair and non-functionality. It was very dysfunctional. Wasn't producing the Kenpos, the great teachers, and it was just he. And so he vowed to go there for 15 years and turn it around, which he did. He did do this, and in order to do this, he had strictly enforced the rules. There was very severe punishments for breaking the rules, and it is said that people feared him like a Yama, the Lord of Death, when he would come. He would visit his home monastery, Dzongsar Monastery, for 2 months in the summer, and then come back to the monastery that he was putting back into shape. And when he came back, the people in the valley, the whole valley, would be trembling in fear, like like. The Lord of Death was coming. He was so strict and so severe. It's funny. You don't see that in his character. But the net result of all this was he brought it back into just a stunningly effective Shadra teaching monastery of producing, you know, just enormous quantities of erudition and great Dharma teaching. And that that from this and other efforts he made, this empowered the future generation of Tibetan Buddhism as they had to flee Tibet. And so the bottom line is that he may be, you know, certainly one of those most responsible, if not the most responsible, for whatever sort of health the Tibetan Buddhism has now in the world, as far as you know, spreading throughout the world and the West. He really is, you know, you might say the key figure in Tibetan Buddhism coming to the West, the key figure, actually. So it's very interesting then that he would come visit me like this in a dream. Now, I'm not a Tibetan Buddhist or anything at all particular. I'm an ecumenical. I'm simply immersed in an ecumenical viewpoint, you might say. But it boils down to the apex approach. It does boil down to what Dzogchen is all about, actually. All the Dharma kings point out the same truth. From whatever tradition, it's all the same. Don't make illusions true and then try to crush them, kill them, defeat them, get rid of them. This is what Jesus says. Don't try to make. This is the trouble that we have. That all gradualist approach is that we take at least some illusions to be true or more true than others. Where the apex approach is to see it all as flat. Now, is this approach possible? Yes, I believe it is. I saw something today in which all my entire life was redeemed, a vision of redemption, you might call it. And I was thinking, how can I redeem my foolish, silly life where I was struggle, struggle, struggle? And then I saw this vision of redemption, and everything was redeemed. It's very, very simple, actually. Very simple. I don't want to get confused by trying to explain it because you lose the simplicity of it, but I guarantee you this vision of redemption is easily there for you, and you will see exactly how it is. And all your whole life will be redeemed for you. See, I thought I wasted my life completely. But in the back of my mind, I said, no, it will be redeemed at some point. It will all be redeemed at some point. And I said, how is that possible, you know? But I know it's possible. And today I saw it. I saw it. I didn't try to grasp it. I just said, oh, okay. This is the vision of redemption. Now, it's easy for me to not grasp because I'm so ecumenical. I've been steeped my whole life in so many traditions that it's just, this is what I am, you know. So I don't have to feel I need to put it into any tradition. My experiencing, I don't have to put it anywhere. I just let it be as it is. And don't try to grasp it. Just let it be as it is. Don't try to stuff it into any tradition at all. Now, this itself could become a tradition of, you know, full stop on the wow, don't try to grasp. Yeah, that is true, but right now it's not. We got a long ways to go before that's any tradition. So we can benefit from this greatly, actually, this attitude. 1,000 years, if you want it to be a tradition. But right now, it's just like as it is. Very helpful, I find. Whatever experience I have, I don't feel like I need to put it anywhere. Or, you know, right? I just let it be as it is. I just let it be as it is. That's it, nothing more. So this is what I recommend. I recommend an ecumenical approach. Because then you don't have to use words, concepts. I don't need to use words or concepts because I'm not trying to fit it into something, or, well, there's more. I saw how we get tricked out of abundance, And that is, the ego says, oh, great, you reached abidance, enlightenment, yeah, great, okay. So have you found the resolve there to that will help us resolve our troubles? And you say, you look around and say, no, I don't see. What? You know, really, you haven't found it yet? Well, maybe you're not quite enlightened. That's the ego tricking us. There's no resolve. Nothing needs to be resolved. So when you say, have you found the resolve yet? You say that there isn't any resolve to find. That's the whole point of enlightenment. That's the, is recognizing nothing needs to be resolved. Everything is intrinsically pure, in pure intrinsic spaciousness. So there's nothing at all needs to resolve. So no one needs to find the resolve from reality to resolve illusions or something. No. Illusions too arise in just intrinsic spaciousness. They're only decorations too. So when this I said, aha, wow. That's how we trick ourselves, isn't it? One of the many tricks, but seeing this one is very helpful. Adds a lot of weight to the scale to tip it, eventually tip it into abidance. There's no resolve to find at all. That's it. That's the whole abidance. No resolve. Nothing is resolved because nothing ever left. It's pure, perfect purity. Nothing ever left perfect purity. So what is there to be resolved? Nothing at all. This is the apex approach. So this is what, apparently, the Tibetans are losing this. And this is a big concern among the top masters, I would say. I would say Jamyang's very concerned about this. Wants to do something about it. Well, I don't doubt he could, you know. he has great experience in this, in restoring stuff that is falling apart and crumbling and losing effectiveness. He's able to get something going and get it thriving somehow. I don't know how, but he's able to. And that wasn't the only, I saw another cone later on in the day, the same thing. It was really quite amazing. The top was gone. I said, uh-oh, that's two in one day. Wow. Meaning the tradition is starting to be frayed and starting to have trouble. This is something I spoke of in another video and I feel is possible. It's possible. I see, I look at the new group of Tibetan Tulkus, Lamas, Rinpoches, Kenpos, etc. And I look at the older generation and I see a big difference. The younger generation, their minds seem troubled. They're concerned. They're troubled. They feel that it's sort of like they feel like the apex approach seems to be vanishing, evaporating, and modern culture is aimed at that, actually. Modern culture, again, existence, the universe, the world, us, bodies, everything, these are all mere conventions. That's all they are. There's no separate reality to any of this. No lack of purity to anything at all. They're just mere convention. The whole thing is just mere convention. Totally. Even enlightenment is a mere convention, the way we pursue it. That too is just a convention. Because it simply distracts us from as it isness. Right? Even the pursuit of enlightenment distracts us from as it isness. So the apex approach just focuses on this fact that everything, including the search for enlightenment, distracts us from as it isness. And all illusions are equally flat. So the severe conventions of the world, which are just brutal, the Tibetans had managed to drive many of those away, and so now that they're being subjected to the world so intensely, it's bound to have some effect. You know, it really is bound to have. It's so brutal, the conventions of the world. And they're traveling so much. What I've shown, they're tired, they're weary, they're traveling so much, they're spreading themselves too thin. And You can keep the trappings of religion when you do this. But if you lose the apex approach, then, hey, hello, Roman Catholicism, right? Trappings are there. The churches are there. The congregation is there. The robes are there. The rituals are there. Everything is there, except the apex approach is not there. Which is really no approach at all. Nothing needs to be approached. Nothing needs to be liberated at all. So this is what ends up vanishing, and you end up with just the trappings. And, you know, you look at the, it's the whole world is that way right now. And so I see a sense of, a subtle sense of bewilderment in the Tibetans of today, a bewilderment. Like, what's happening? You know, what's happening to us? There's a slight inner bewilderment is there. You can see it. It's obvious to me. Look at Zhangyang, and there's no bewilderment there in his face. None whatsoever. Samsara, it was just the ocean of conventions, is extremely can be extremely bewildering if we don't view it in the right context. So I went through this very profound consideration today. I said the best friends you have is are those who help you start good habits. And so the austerity of the Tibetans is still there to some extent, not like it used to be by any means. There are, a lot of them are globetrotters right now. They're not sitting in a cave for 40 years. So the austerity is not like it used to be. But relatively speaking, to the rest of the world, I mean, they seem very austere and disciplined and all this. This is a very good thing. You don't want, if you lose austerity, then you really have lost it all, really. It's like if you lose that work ethic, the austerity of just, then whatever anyone says is just in one ear and out the other, really. It's just pop religion. Yeah, I read a book. I read a book last year or something. Yeah. I went and saw this, went and saw this teacher. Okay. That's not austerity. So the contemporary world cringes from austerity. It freaks it out completely. It doesn't even know what it is. I did a video yesterday, 2.5 hours, and then I transcribed the best sayings from the video, spent 2.5 hours more watching the video, I'm transcribing it. That's like 5 hours right there. And then the other rest of the day was spent in intense works with graphics and, study and everything. And so like it's 24/7. This is, I've led a very austere life, actually. And this is necessary to have this sense, to have this austerity. So if you're poor, if you don't have a lot of, if you live an austere life, you're very blessed, actually, extremely blessed. The worst thing of all is to be wealthy and able to distract yourself with money, all the distractions it can buy. That's a disaster for you. Yet it's becoming more and more difficult to lead an austere life here. Where there's so many fees now. It's like, I feel like you're bound to run afoul of the bureaucracy and government and everything else. Bound to run afoul of it because it just, the fees in every which direction, you just have to have a constant inpouring of money along with everything you buy breaks in a couple months. You have to keep replacing everything. It's unbelievable. If you buy a water heater, it breaks in a couple months. You buy a refrigerator, someone's washing machine. They say, I just got this washing machine less than a year ago. Not brand new, top brand. It's broken. Had to buy a new one. It's too expensive to fix it. So these are, $600, $800, here. And oh, a year later, another 800. I mean, this is crazy. Before, you'd spend 200 on a washing machine. It would last you for 30 years. So this is this whole planet right now. It's actually on purpose. You have to understand this is purposeful. Remember, we're all bodhisattvas, and we're engaged in this convention of believing in another realm that's separate from reality. So we're very clever in how to keep this convention going of believing in this, as if we think, oh, it's true, it's really true, because all these conventions infer it. You might say they infer it. We never actually experience it, but we infer, well, it must be somewhere. I feel like we're really there, but I'm not really quite experiencing it yet. But I know it's around here somewhere, and it's like that. So, the plan is to simply break down all austerity and get everybody just working constantly for money, money chasing after money. Whereas if you get stuff that lasts, we have pots and pans that are over 100 years old, I think, that were passed on to my grandmother, then passed on to my mom, and I mean, and they still work great. I mean, we have those older stuff was made to last, not just a lifetime, but several lifetimes actually. So people had time for austerity. They had time for austerity. As I said, my grandmother was just a city clerk, and she retired and spent the last 30 years of her life traveling the world on a clerk, city clerk's salary, because everything she bought it for a lifetime, and she never had to buy it again. And so she'd save up and buy a sofa, save up, do this dining room table, whatever. Never had to buy anything like it. And so she just, the rest of her life, her apartment was just there. And she'd travel the world, she'd come back, and everything was fine. And she'd stay for a little while and travel some more and come back. And so she had time for austerity. Now, she didn't use it for, she used it for traveling, which was, it's not the best choice by any means. But the principle is, she could have had time for austerity. And spent the last 30 years of her life in deep contemplation, for instance, right? Well, I've been able to spend my entire life in deep contemplation based on circumstances that arose. And so I've been supremely fortunate in that regard. But most of us, it's just the world is designed for all this junk. Purposely to sabotage and undermine our desire to set the desire to be separate, set that desire down. We have a desire to set it down, actually. We say, we're tired of this. This is foolish, So the undermining of austerity in this world is a really, really severe termite job, to say the least. Watch this. And it's just ridiculous. Every day I see stuff. I put the little cap back on my tire today. I had to put some air in the tire, and I was screwing it on, and what the cap of the little top of the cap, I was, it just kind of broke and came off. I said, what? I mean, that never used to happen. The cap that you screw on the valve on your tire, those things would last forever. I mean, they're heavy duty. This thing, these days, they just get deformed. They break. The top pops out. It's junk. It's junk. It's junk. We get this brand new vacuum cleaner, and the hose just breaks. First time on the job, breaks, and then taped it broke again. I have to order a new one, over $30, right? And on the time and effort and everything, it's just insane. The very first day we used it, the hose just split. And then they said, that was a freak thing, no? Split again yesterday. They said, wow, this is a piece of junk. And this was like the highest of the line, the most expensive Very expensive. Best thing, this thing should last, like I said, it's gonna last for 10 years. This is, no, it lasted like a day. So this is sabotage. I have to tell you that you have to realize this doesn't happen by accident. It doesn't happen by accident at all. This is a massive effort. I mean, we are not nat we don't naturally produce stuff that breaks the first day we use it. I mean, we're driven to, for quality. Most of it, we want quality. I love glass because, the glass can last. This bottle could last hundreds of years. Okay, that's why people have these antiques glass stuff. It's still good. It's wonderful. Glass vases, stuff. Pass them on, pass them on, pass them on. Hundreds and hundreds of years, they're still good. So it's intentional. This junk, it's a mindset, a collective mindset to sabotage our desire for austerity, which would say, just give me a few good things, a simple life, a simple culture, stuff that lasts. So I don't have to, like a house, I don't have to fix it every couple years. Here in California, people are ceaselessly having to fix their roofs, remodel this. Everything's falling apart here. Where like in Europe, the house is made of stone or concrete or stone or something. The houses have been there for a thousand years or more. And they built it to last, and so you don't have to constantly be fixing everything. It's unbelievable here how much stuff has to be redone constantly. So how could you have, nobody has an austere lifestyle here. They're too frantically trying to make money. This is true. It's absolutely true. It's better to have just a little hut and enough food and spend your days in contemplation. So I've been able to spend my whole life in contemplation. So that this then grad you know this gradually you see that the gradualist approach doesn't really work. And that the apex is not an approach at all. So no approach is the approach. And there's another nice little mantra for you. No approach is the approach. This is a way of honoring our creativity and words, which is just some creativity, and setting it down gently. No approach is the approach. No approach is the right approach. No approach is the right approach. And you can look at that two different ways, can't you? You can say that none of the approaches that anyone uses is right. Okay, so no approach is the right right approach. That'd be a negative way of looking at on one side. And then in the positive way, you'd be saying that not taking any approach at all is the right approach. You can look at it that way. Or you can look at it both ways. So it's kind of a very interesting statement, right? You can look at it both ways. No approach is the right approach. No approach is the right approach. Now, trying to teach, the Westerners, the Tibetans, were so fixated, on science and gradualism and all just all these conventions that, it must be driving them nuts. I mean, trying to teach the apex perspective of, that no approach is the right approach. It just like. I think it's like a teacher with students that are so regressed, so badly struggling, challenged, learning challenged, that after a while, the teacher trying just to reach them and to help them, the teacher themselves starts to forget, what they really know, and they get pulled down. So I feel that the foolishness of the world, if you really try to teach too much, it can pull you down. It can really pull you down. That's why teachers get vacations. They should, especially ones with challenged children. Maybe the Tibetans could use a vacation, now and then. I'm sure they get them, and but they need to recharge their batteries and recover. Yet no approach is the right approach. But it's frustrating trying to teach. I know. It just seems like nobody gets it. And trying to understand why, what, why doesn't anybody? Well, they're trying to redeem their life. But what I saw today is the vision of redemption. It's redemption is just this instant. Anyone can have their entire life redeemed this very instant. So this is a very, very profound experience I had today. Very, very important. Because we're ceaselessly trying to do something to redeem the regrets that we have in the past, right? We feel, I regret that I wasted my life. I mean, how, so I've got to do something with my life that's like, to count, offset those regrets. But what I saw is that everything I've ever done, like rose petals falling from heaven, all were falling into this beautiful vision of sameness and redemption. And it was all, they're all completely redeemed. Everything was completely redeemed. Wow. And then you realize you don't need to do anything. Just experience this redemption. But again, I'm just letting it sit there, not trying to put it, stuff it into any tradition. And this is what the apex approach says. Don't stuff it into any tradition, which is why Nyingma Buddhism has had trouble with the Sarma, the three or four, we ought to put it, more modern traditions of Buddhism. Nyingma has never held political power. They've always kind of, it's also been a lay movement, a lot of lay people, and it's non-monastic, not really taught so much in universities, and it's mostly, just some person sitting in the suburbs somewhere, and this person here, it can be a householder, you don't have to be a monk to do it, study it. It's never had any centralized authority either, until just recently the Dalai Lama asked if somebody would fulfill that role, but it's always been very ecumenical within itself. And so I fit very well within the Nyingma tradition. It's like a perfect fit almost. I feel very comfortable within it. And I don't really have to change anything. I can check all the boxes. Check. Yeah, so everything, just like, if you go over everything they're about, just fits. Apex approach fits. Yeah. So they themselves didn't feel they needed to stuff their understanding into some tradition. It was more just enlightenment. That's the tradition, is be enlightened. And then bring others to that enlightenment through the apex approach, already there-ness. Absolute already there-ness. 100% already there-ness. 100% already there-ness. So we don't have to stuff it into any tradition. They were persecuted because of this. Yes, they're persecuted a lot because politics enters into all of that, and they're very apolitical. As am I, actually. Like I said, I haven't paid attention to the news for almost a year, and I really don't care about politics at all, actually. I say it, all politics is spiritual politics, which is true. So there are these interesting archetypal things going on. So from time to time I mention them. But my mind is not a political mind at all. I can completely tune it out and really have no interest in politics or governance or anything like that. So that fits well. The Nyingma tradition tends to stay out of politics, out of social issues, politics, all that stuff. It just wants to focus on this, the apex view, the already as it isness, the already as it isness, is not greater than anything because it's the only view there is, actually. So how could it be greater than something? As it is, there's nothing other than that. So how could there be something? How can we say that's a greater view, the greatest? That means there's some other view? No, there's no other view. What we think is viewpoint is not at all. It's just whimsicality, convention. It's just pretending to adopt this convention. We adopt all these conventions, and we think that's a viewpoint. It's no view. It's no view at all, actually. Pretending that what we're saying is there's a view around here somewhere. I just haven't seen it yet, but I know it's. Maybe it's that thing over there, you know. So maybe it's that thing. So we think all these things might provide a viewpoint for us of a separate reality, and yet it always feels kind of it feels blank, doesn't it? It's like I'm not really getting the view because there's nothing there to view. It's like we spend all our time trying to see what isn't here. I woke up this morning. I started working. And I suddenly burst out into laughter as I'm taping. I was taping on a voice recorder. It's like everyone in the world is frantically trying to see what's not here. They're all focused, instead of being focused on what is here, as it isness, we're all focused on as it isn'tness, as it isn'tness, and trying to see the isn'tness, trying to see what isn't here. And of course, we've never found it because it's not here to see. How do you see what's not here? Now I'm going to ask that question. How do we see what's not here? Has anyone seen what's not here? Has anyone ever seen what's not here? I'd like to ask that question. And ask that question of yourself. Has anyone ever seen what's not here? This is like a wow type of question. Has anyone ever come across what's not here? Anyone, ever, anywhere. They said, ah, I finally am seeing what's not here. That's not here now. Has anyone ever seen what's not here right now? This instant. Has anyone ever seen anything other than this instant? Than the instant, as it is instant. Has anyone ever seen anything other than as it is instant? I reached a goal today in the workouts. As we just let this question just kind of sit there. Just let it sit there. Don't answer it. Just let it sit there. We don't need to answer it. It's self-evident, right? So you just let it sit there. Get familiar with the question. Has anyone ever seen what's not here? This very instant. Has anyone ever seen anything other than this instant? The instantness, instantaneousness, the spontaneity. Has anyone ever seen anything other than the spontaneity? Of isness. Anywhere, any place in the universe, has anyone ever seen what's not here? Has anyone ever come across it? Has anyone ever come across what's not here right now? There's this yoga girl. There's a bunch of them working out. And some more so than others. Really. Some are over the top, to say the least. just it is what it is. And but she was just hammering in the work. I just wow. It's like wow. Very determined, dogged and determined. Not going fast or anything, but just relentless, relentless. I said, man, okay, I'm not up to your standard yet. You got this one, that is for sure. But it's important to recognize this, that what's coming up in the world, I would say it's a manic depressive world is coming. So you don't want to get hooked in either manic or depressive phases. So you want to feel as though, yeah, I could do that if I wanted to. Also, yeah, I could not do that if I wanted to. I could be manic if I wanted to, or I could be depressed if I wanted to, but I don't really want to. I don't want to do that. I don't need to. And so it's a buffer. This is how I see it, like getting in this kind of shape. Well, I mean, yeah, the yoga girls can hammer their workouts. I mean, they are like, I mean, this is very impressive. The will and determination is just extraordinary. Not anyone special or athletic or anything, but just someone who had in their heart, this is my purpose in life, and I'm just doing it. So I could hang with her, for a while, but she just wouldn't stop. So I said, that's okay, I'm leaving. That's enough. It's enough for me for now. Later I'll do some more. It's okay. So when a mania comes, one of the keys to success is don't get pulled into the manias or the depressions. It's sort of stick, like Buddha said, the middle path. It's a very brilliant, very helpful recognition of this, is don't get pulled into the manias or the depressions. And so if there's like a fitness mania that comes, I could say, should I join it? Oh my gosh, should I join it? I really need to get fit. Oh yeah, I'm really out of shape. Oh, look at these yoga girls will help me get in shape. And they're such incredible shape. Like, oh my gosh, this is shameful. And it's scary. Like, I'm so out of shape. It's scary because it can contrast. It scares you. Contrast can scare us, is the problem. Hope and fear, contrast. And you think, well, I'm nothing compared to them. I don't want to feel like nothing. So it's significant. And then they hold out their hands. And, we'll help you. Don't worry. Come to us and we'll help you. And you think, wow, what a blessing, And then you get pulled into the manias, the various manias, and then the depressions, the manic depressive mindset, actually, which the ego's mindset is really manic depressive. Everyone's manic depressive in the world. Everybody here is fixated, manic depressive, arrogant. We're all suffering from buying into these conventions, which is this whole belief system of the ego. The whole world is everything's just a convention, a way of trying to make believe that separate reality is possible or even exists. And so if you're in good enough shape, you have a buffer there, and you could say, well, I'm not going to join you right now, but maybe later I will, because right now I'm in really pretty darn good shape. I could be in better shape. I'd like to be a little better, I know that, but I'm not like in an emergency. It's not like an extreme thing. I don't really have to join what you're doing right now, but maybe later I'll join it. So this is really pragmatic advice, is to how to survive. Literally, you have to be very, very wise about this. Now, this comes from a lifetime of experience and struggling with this, and a lot of success and some failures. So I understand it's a very tricky thing indeed. Now, there's also this cult that's amazing. I'm seeing of the body beautiful, of modifying the body to look. I mean, there's these yoga girls who look like Barbie dolls. It's the weirdest thing. I look at like, these stars in Disney movies and stuff or whatever, that just on Facebook you see advertisers on. What? These posters. And they look like wax mannequins. They look like mannequins. They look like they're not even human. It's the weirdest thing. Like little dolls, Barbie dolls or something. It's really weird. So there's this big cult that is like a mania that's likely to rise in the world. All sorts of manias are likely to arise in this world. The yoga girls are the plague. They have all they're carrying these manias within them to spring them upon the world. And maybe that deer was had something to do with a female deer was, activating it in some way, right? And the males get all activated, they get manic, they run in front of their vehicle. But this is what happens. There's an activation that happens. I remember the Beatles, that was a mania. It was an extreme mania, and there's the women that activated them, no question about it. It was scary. It was so scary. It basically almost ruined my life, actually. It was very scary. The men were the boys. We were just shocked and scared out of our wits. The women suddenly went berserk. They turned into these shrieking maniacs. They were maniacs. They went manic. We were plodding along, and everything was we're getting along. Everyone was getting along, and suddenly the women was flipped into this manic phase, and they've taken us on this roller coaster ride ever since. We've been dancing to their tune. So ever since the Beatles, we've been pretty much. It started with Elvis. It's got it going really in the U.S., but and. We were dumbfounded. We didn't know what to do. We were wandering around like idiots. It's kind of hard to do. What do you do when half of the people are suddenly flip into a manic, become manic? Well, a lot of us became depressed to try and balance it out, That's what I did. I became depressed to try to deal with the manicness of the girls. It's crazy. I really, the Beatles are, of course, they're talented, except I really don't like them because of culturally what they did. Very negative influence, actually. Extremely negative influence culturally. It was all set up by Tavistock Institute and pharmaceutical companies and all the stuff behind the EMI, and there was an enormous corporate think tank push behind the Beatles, actually. It was a very nasty thing. Beach Boys were a much more organic situation. It didn't produce the mania at all. It didn't produce the manicness at all. It was much more of a mellow sort of thing, laid back California sort of thing. It still is. Just there's something about it. So it was very different. I have a massive experience with culture and the manias and everything that's been happening the last 60 years on this planet. So I'm scared. I know what can happen. When women become manic, it's the scariest thing there is in the world. There's nothing more frightening. And we're set for that to happen very soon. Remember in Nazi Germany, it was the women that went manic. And the normal men were just like, what's going on here? This is very scary. It was the women that turned Hitler into a rock star. The Fräuleins. They went extremely manic. And he fed their frenzy, their manic frenzy, like the Beatles fed the manic frenzy of the girls. They poured gasoline on the fire of their mania. We must have this uber, living space, the fatherland, this all this. This is coming from the women, actually. And Hitler just fed all that, and he was in love with his own being this orator and a statesman and a leader. And sound familiar? Got sort of one of those as the POTUS right now. Very narcissistic, very thinking that they're a person of destiny and history and stuff, and so they just feed the, they pour gasoline on the fire, keep pouring gasoline on the fire to produce more and more mania, more and more mania. They want to hear all the screams and adulation and people fainting and stuff like that. So if you start seeing a mania, you got to tone it down. If you're an artist, you say, hey, this is not good. Let's tone it down here. Don't play to that crowd. Okay, don't play to that crowd. Don't whip things up into a frenzy. Don't go for the frenzy, all the stuff that triggers frenzy and mania in your art, anything like that. Calm, subdued. It can still be joyful, you know, without the mania sort of thing. Absolutely it can. It can be danceable. It doesn't have to be a mania. Okay, it does not have to trigger that. So this has been going on throughout history. I've always said that girls are the most dangerous thing there is in a convention, there is in existence. They most certainly are. They most certainly are. And young maidens, absolutely, it's the biggest deceit there is. You know, it's nature, the deceitfulness of nature. And you think, oh, this is so wonderful. Well, check back, you know, at menopause and see how wonderful it is. Or check back in old age, or check back in this, you know, as you go through these. It's like, wow, what a false advertising, you know, extreme false advertising. That's nature. Nature always puts out this false advertising. But the mania that they can bring is like a tsunami, actually. And then this can trigger a counter, try to balance it, a severe depression. Right now, in fact, most of the men are very depressed in the world. So many men are very severely depressed. They're on so many antidepressants. And you just see them. I just see them, you know. I could tell they're depressed. Chronically low-grade depression. Everyone in this world's in despair. Or at least the convention that we think we're in a world is just a convention. But it's chronic despair. But many, many, many men have this now depression. Not quite as much the older men. The younger men and the women, a lot of them have mania. They're suffering from chronic mania in a lot of ways. And this is all very distracting and prevents genuine austerity from taking place. Depression is not what you're looking for in austerity, okay, because you can hardly function and you can't concentrate your mind. Now, so back to being fit, looking pretty decent and good, and feeling good about yourself and stuff. You could say, let's, you know, I could get with that aerobics or so. But you know, not today, because I'm focusing on John Myung Khyentse Choekyi Lodro. I'm focusing on what he has to say. I'm focusing on being part of the Nyingma tradition. You know, what can we do to help him? Because the Tibetans may be the best thing we have going for us in the world in terms of their austerity and good habits, which is really, don't worry about the teaching and the Vajrayana, all this stuff. It's the austerity and the practicing, the habits of practicing every day and the austerity that they have and all that. Those are the good habits that last a lifetime. And then you can use those to actually then view from the apex approach, the unviewable view of the apex approach, no approach is the right approach, the unapproachable approach, the unviewable view, because has anyone ever seen anything other than as it isness? Has anyone ever seen anything other than as it isness? That is a question. Just let that question, you know, sit there like a flower, like a beautiful lotus blossom. You've just been given this beautiful lotus blossom, and just take the flower and put it in some water and just let it sit, see how long it lasts, just let it sit there. Has anyone ever seen, ever experienced anything other than as it isness? And is it not just a convention to presume otherwise? Is it not just sheer convention, nothing other than that, to presume otherwise? Is it not just sheer presumption and the convention of presumption to presume otherwise? came home and I, what did I do? I strawberry protein drink, Odwalla strawberry protein drink, a bunch of tart red cherry juice, and some chocolate protein powder, and I blended that up in a Nutribullet blender and chugged that thing down. Wow. Because boy, did I hit a workout today. I mean, you want to work out? I can work out with you. You're going to say, I don't know about that. But here's this little yoga girl, kind of, you know, just chugging away. And, you know, she worked out more than I did. It's like a tortoise. She wouldn't stop. And so, you know, but there again, you know, so I hit my mark, you know, I hit my mark. And so I've been pretty doggone, that's pretty impressive to hit the mark I did today. So again, when the manias and the depressions come, you know, you can say, well, you know, not right now, but maybe I could do that later. And depression's another thing, we could look at that. I haven't really looked at that, but that would be just not to do anything as far as working out or anything. As a countermeasure, try to avoid the mania by not doing anything. But when you do that, you're... concentration is affected. You become more slothful. It's harder to do it. It has some sort of a diminishing returns as well. You tend to start fantasizing a lot of what you would do if you really weren't, you know, not so depressed. And so you sort of enter into a fantasy realm, which is really bad. You don't want to do that. You want to stay the apex. As it isness, you want to keep glimpsing that as it isness and say, is there anything else to glimpse, actually? I mean, is there anything else to see, actually? Are we actually seeing anything other than this? Is anyone at all? No. Not. So, the middle path is Buddha sought. The Buddha sought that so brilliantly, so wisely. You know, I'm seeing what he's talking about more and more. It's very profound. So he looked like a sort of a prosperous middle-aged businessman, you know, in pretty good shape, and no trace of austerity in him. Well, not austerity, but what is the when he. Caused a lot of trouble for his body and put it through, you know, it's extreme. Well, I don't know what the word is, but no trace of trying to starve himself to death, that kind of thing. Maybe you could say severe austerities, you know, extreme austerities, you know, no sign of extreme austerities. And he looks like somebody that just doesn't really, you know, no extremes there. And so he could say, you know, yeah, I could do either, you know, either the trance states or the severe austerities. But, you know, not right now. But, you know, I could get into either one of those. It wouldn't be such a big deal. So if the yoga girls say, hey, we got this extreme workout, guys, you know, really going to get y'all in shape. You're in such terrible shape. You know, and they go into this manic phase. I said, you know, that is extreme for sure. Give you your due. I can see that, you know, your core is, you know, just absolutely like nails. That's been working really, 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 really diligently on that because I know it's not easy. And so, yeah, I could do that. You know, it wouldn't be easy, but I could do it. But, you know, I'm not going to do it right now because I've got something more important to do. Like that. Or if someone's really depressed, you know, you could say, you know, yeah, I could see how just getting into this mental state like that is something that's doable. I've been there, so I know it's doable. And I'm not like manic, so I could do that. It's possible I could do that, sure. I could just get into this overly self-absorbed condition and fantasy land and stuff. But, you know, not right now. Not right now. Maybe a little later I can get into that. If I really feel like it, if something better doesn't come along, maybe I'll do that. But right now I got something better, so I don't really, I'm not going to do it right now, but maybe later. So you have to finesse the world. Okay, you have to finesse it like this. You have to finesse it. And this is the lacking of wisdom. It's very hard to get this wisdom. I mean, I've worked at it my whole life. I say, well, how do you deal with this world? It's so crazy. It's so difficult. And you have to finesse it, or you have to kind of be able to say whatever arises, you can say, yeah, I could do that, but not right now. Yeah, I could go in that direction right now. I could go in this crazy wisdom direction, but not right now. I could go in this kooky, I could go in a gender bender direction, but not right now. I could go in this kooky direction right now. I could go in this fitness mania right now. I could go in this musical mania. I could go any of these directions, 360 degree, but not right now. Not right now, because I'm able to get with this apex. No viewpoint is the viewpoint. No approach is the right approach. I'm able to get with this. No approach is the right approach. And so that's, so far nobody has pointed out to me that they ever experienced what is not here right now. So until that's pointed out, I'm going to stick with what is here right now. And if someone actually says, yeah, I really did experience what is not here right now, then, maybe I can get into mania or depression as a way to try to get with this convention that this is possible. But so far, I see zero evidence that this is possible. You're experiencing what is not here to experience? Really? Even a fantasy is here to experience right now, is it not? Isn't the fantasy of the future being experienced right now also? So when do we experience something that isn't right now? That's the question, isn't it? So we say, yay, until we start really getting a lot of evidence this is possible. I mean, it just, the mania and depression is not indicated yet, but if it's indicated, yeah, I can get with either way, anything, three, any, I can get with anything that the world, throwing out there. I really could. They want me to, become a fashionista? Absolutely, it'd be a piece of cake for me. I could do. I've been there, done that. A lot of stuff. I've already been there and done that in terms of just, seeing what it would be like if I ever decided I needed to do that. So now I say, oh yeah, it's no problem. Fashionista, of course I could. Ah, totally. Are you kidding? Whatever. Whatever, ever, ever, anything and everything the fashion industry could throw out there, I could easily wear it all and do it all. It's not even an issue. Could wear, 1,000 hats a day, kind of thing. And just like, yeah, okay, here's another hat. Okay, here's another hat. Another hat, and just constant, wardrobe changes. And just like, oh, okay, it's no big deal. Singing, any sort of music, anything at all. But until we start really finding out that someone's experiencing what's not here to experience, none of that's really indicated, is it? Not yet. Not yet. When do we experience what is not here right now? This is the question. When do we experience what is not here right now? Maybe that deer symbolized the mania. It was like the deer was in a manic state. Yeah, and maybe that's it. That's probably it, because I've been on this today really intensely, and the deer was just like crazy. His eyes are like this, and just like frantic. What are you doing? Just leaping out in the middle of a road? Just why can't you walk out there? I mean, can't you just kind of browse, kind of look, look around? Let me just like calmly walk. No, the freaking deer, leapt 6 feet or more than that. It suddenly must have leapt 8 feet, from the bushes into the middle of the road. So that's a manic state, isn't it? So I was able to break and not hit this manic state. Only the grace of God prevented me from hitting this deer. I mean, in other words, going into a manic condition. But I was going slow enough, singing the Beach Boys. I was relaxed, singing the Beach Boys. I wasn't, no caffeine, no, you know, nothing manic about me. I was just calm, kind of driving slowly. Boom, I was able to hit the brake and, you know, slow down enough so it just missed the deer. I was able to slow down. You see that? So I was going slow, so I was able to slow down. And I had great brakes. I was able to hit the brakes, you know, and slow down enough so I didn't hit the deer. In other words, become manic, go into this manic condition. Wow. Very, very profound. We talk about people, I know the Tibetans talk about their compassion and stuff, but that's great. It really is. And this here, what we're talking about, is super pragmatic, you know, like from someone who's been on the front lines their whole life, who really knows how you really get hooked and how trouble really comes to you. It's not out of just a lack of compassion, etc. It comes to you through these manias. Very, very difficult. Because it comes at you from every angle. This world comes at you from every angle, and you have to be able to say, maybe not right now. Okay, so you have to have some way to deflect it off of you, right? And stay with your practicing. It's been extremely difficult for me to practice my whole life. Extremely difficult. It's a battle because everything is pulling at me, right? The whole world is pulling at you too. It's 360 degrees is pulling at you. It's trying to hook you into a viewpoint, which is a convention. This whole world is just a convention. Everything here is merely convention. It's just an image. It's flat. It's just a convention of believing that there's something to see other than what is here right now. There's something to experience other than what's here right now. Isn't all experience in the now? Isn't a fantasy in the now? Isn't a thought of 1,000 years in the future in the now? Isn't a thought of 1,000 years in the past also in the now? So when are we not in the now? When are we not in the now? And so the conventions are to avoid this recognition, which is what manias and depressions are designed. They're conventions, defensive conventions designed to avoid seeing there is no separate reality. To avoid seeing it. So these defense systems are always operating. And they're nasty, really horrible, and dangerous, very dangerous. The plagues, worse than the Black Death, these manias are like plagues, spiritual plagues. So I left the workout, and that yoga girl said, I don't know how, maybe she's still working out, I don't know. But I said, look, that's enough for me right now. I'm in touch with my own body, and that I just hammered it. I reached my goal, so that I'm going to stop now. But there was a temptation to think like, you know, hey, if she can do it, I got it, I can do it too, come on. No. I mean, because that's not my purpose. It's not my purpose to see how much I can do. That's a mania. Okay, my purpose is just to make sure I don't get caught up in a mania of seeing how much I can do. How fast can I do it? How much can I do? And then push that. You know, and this then tips over into a mania. And manias come at us from all different directions. And we'll be surprised, you know, a mania is coming. There's always something coming in this world in terms of manic and depressive that pushes us and pulls us and tatters us and batters us. Always. It's a defense system. It's a convention. It's part of the convention of the defense system of distracting us from the simple fact that are we ever experiencing anything that isn't in the now, actually? Are we ever seeing anything that's not in the now? Is there anything that is not in the now? Is there anything that is not in the now? Maybe the guys will go crazy for weightlifting or something coming up. I mean, that hits waves of that hit, you know, fitness things. I saw some guy today with his shirt off. You know, he was just so pumped up. It was ridiculous. Of course, he's walking his dog. You know, it's like looked like something out of a Marvel comics book or something. I mean, he's a cartoon character. Yes, and I say like, wow, you know. Well, yeah. I mean, if you take some supplements that generate, you know, testosterone and various things like that. And, I mean, they're illegal in sports, but you can get those. I mean, people, you know, these people are using all sorts of stuff that they can get freakishly. The muscles get freakishly large like that, and you can just dedicate your life every day. I know people every day at the gym. They're just pumping iron. I do a little bit of that, and you know, there's a lot of little muscle there. I see a little bit of muscle, yeah. tiny, but it's a little stronger. I say, it's pretty good. I'm a little bit stronger. There's no doubt I'm a little bit stronger. I carried something today, lifted something, hurt my back a little bit, but this is really heavy, super heavy stuff. But I was able to do it. I said, wow, I'm a lot stronger than I used to be. But I don't want to become freakishly pumped up, you know. But that's the temptation, isn't it? Because we have the means to do that now, don't we? Yeah, I mean, if I took those supplements that altered the chemistry, you know, endocrine chemistry, your body and everything, start, I could pump up, but it'll probably kill you, you know, at some point. That you don't want to be messing with your body chemistry in that way, I don't think. And the young kids are working out. They're, you know, they're in great shape. So that's fine. That's good for them. But I held my own, you know. I mean, I held my own. So I did. It wasn't like a standout, you know. Either way, like, this guy's really out of shape, or this guy's in great shape. I'm just kind of, you know, I just held my own. So people, yeah, okay. He's here. He's doing it. Good for him, you know. My head's pounding. Boom, it was a hot day today. Boom, 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 boom. Whew, yeah, I was really felt the, you know, tremendous cardio situation. And so you feel, you know, like, I mean, there are plenty of people doing more, you know. But I felt like, you know, I'm there, you know. I'm not getting my doors blown off. It's like back in the drag race days. You don't have to have the fastest car. You know, you got a nice muscle car. It's good enough back then. I remember a friend of mine had a car. It was pretty strong. I can't remember what it was, but that was a powerful car. All the cars back then were powerful and fast. He had one that was. Boy, you stepped on the gas, and that thing was just a beast, absolute beast. And of course, another one had a Dodge Dart, which is a beast also, fast. But you didn't have to have the fastest car. It's enough that you had a muscle car. It doesn't have to be the fastest one. But you know, hey, you feel like you're in the middle of the pack. You know, it's okay. So you're kind of in the middle of the pack. The hippie thing came, you know, tried to be in the middle of the pack there, which was kind of difficult. They were so far out. Yeah, you wore your paisley shirts and your sailor bell bottoms, and wore your leather moccasins and drew your hair long and played guitar and things and stuff. And you tried to, you know, just kind of be in the middle of the pack without going too far one way or the other, and then tried to then keep focusing. But it's difficult for all of us. It's super difficult because constantly we feel that something is trying to, you know, ensnare us, right? Some viewpoint is trying to ensnare us instead of just as it isness, which there's it's not a viewpoint, because show me another viewpoint. Before we talk about viewpoint, first establish that there's some other, there's two. I mean, where's anything other than right now? And all right, so if there's nothing, There's nothing yet been established there, so how can we even talk about viewpoint? What's the purpose of talking about viewpoint? If there's only just this one, you know, this is all there is, why do we even have a concept about it at all? Why the concept of viewpoint? So I believe the Holy Spirit is telling me there's probably going to be like some body beautiful fixation coming up. The yoga girls are going to get into some mania. As a matter of fact, I think they will. They've trained very, very heavily for this, for some sort of to spring some mania upon the world. And believe me, they're capable of it, more than capable of it. Don't underestimate the yoga girls. I try not to underestimate them. Those who are driving the bus, the mania bus. Saw a hippie bus recently. Wow, a bus that's all hippied out. I haven't seen that in a long time. Long time. I said, uh-oh. Is that what's coming? Is another hippie thing, mania coming? It's possible. Keep in mind, it was the yoga girls that drove the whole hippie thing in the first place. And a lot of them were you know, they're yoga girls, meaning they were wealthy. They were high society. They were upper middle class intellectuals and stuff. And they sprung this whole, you know, and some of them are CIA. Some of them were working for various think tanks, etc. Actually, they were. You'd be surprised how many women are spies, how many work for these think tanks. Many, many do. It's a little secret that isn't well known in the world. The best spies in Russia were women, by far. So many Russian women were trained as spies. So many Eastern European women, so many were trained as spies and agents, undercover agents. They're very good at it. They're way better than men, actually. Way better. And this, the communist countries know that. So they use them a lot. And it's the same thing here in the West, is women are used a lot in these black ops undercover operations, and you never suspect it. You never suspect it. Then you only find out later, or not at all, actually. And they recruit the men. They're very good recruiters. And they pull the artists in and the various spiritual, sort of spiritual types, charismatic types. They pull them in and say, hey, we need, you know, so they're very good at recruiting charismatic types. This is what these think tanks, these black ops things, the doyens of culture, the shapers of culture, the grand dames of culture, you know, manipulating culture. They do it through charismatic types, and they use these spies, these undercover agents, to recruit these charismatic types. Lots of men, charismatic men, often women too, and they manipulate them, and they, you know, hook them, and you know, the rest is history. But what history has not happened in the now? Can anyone point that out? What right now, thinking about Roman times? Well, that thought about Roman times. You know, where is that thought? Is it in Roman times, or is it right here now? And has there ever been any place other than right here now? So there's likely to be a massive operation coming up, a mania. The yoga girls are going to hit it hard, and many of them have contacts in probably in these various, you know, connected to these think tanks and their whole octopus apparatus that interlaces the world, actually. Many of them extremely well-funded, extremely well-connected, and untouchable, basically, as far, you know, really untouchable. I don't want to get too political. So I still have that, but it does tend to go along political lines to some extent. It absolutely does. The think tanks have had a lot of success, and that success that they've had in engineering society, it has arisen as a certain political party in the United States, for instance. And the ones who have not yet been seduced by these yoga girls are the other political party, pretty much. Pretty much how it goes. And once you're seduced, liberal, well, the culture that was seduced, I was part of that culture, and I've had to fight my way out of it. So I know how sticky it is. It's really terrible, very nasty stuff. They're very, very slick and cynical and seductive. And once you get into that, it's like a tar pit. It's very difficult to get out. The 60s was manipulated. It really was. It was a social engineering situation that took place, designed to set up what is going on right now, actually. It was a long-term plan. Undermine the, family, the role of women, the religion, in which the role of women and religion go together, and the family goes, it all goes together. Undermine all of that, and make children turn to the state for their authority and for their guidance and for everything. This has been the purpose of these, to create a central one-world government that destabilize society, culture, traditional society, traditional culture, family unit, the community. It turn everybody against one another. All this stuff designed to for everybody to turn to political authority, bureaucratic political authority, which is one world despotic dictatorship government, which is what the think tanks, that's what they're recommending for the world, that this is the way we got to go. Of course, this just simply distracts us from what our austerity, which religions help bring people into austerity. That's why it's so valuable. Read your Bible every night. Read your Bible every morning. That's austerity. We don't need to get arguing about what's in the Bible, because the good habits of austerity are there, and that's going to bear fruit eventually, for sure. Practicing everyday humility, compassion, humility, austerity, practice, prayers, belief in the grace of God, all this stuff, that is going to eventually bear fruit. I don't care what you're reading, because the truth within you will begin to emerge. So there were some Christians really began to get fruit throughout history. They absolutely have. And you, of course, you could say that, many people are confused, as they read their Bibles, etc. Okay, yeah. But the habits, the good habits that they have, eventually that's going to bear fruit. And this is what the New World Order doesn't want. It doesn't want us to have good habits. It wants us to have bad habits. That's the only way we can remain distracted from the obviousness of as it isness, is have many, many very bad habits. And so the bad habits, they want to institutionalize really bad habits. That's what the New World Order is, just this convention of having really bad habits. That's all it is. That's all you can say about it. It's just this conglomeration of many bad habits, this convention of entertaining these bad habits, pretending to have these bad habits. That's all it is. There's nothing glamorous about it at all. It's just a whole bunch of bad habits. And in order to do that, get there, they've got to break our good habits. So that's what they've been trying to do. And people really have lost their good habits in this world. Very, very few maintain their good habits. Those who do are holding on by a thread. It's not easy. I know it's real difficult. Yet it is very doable. It's very doable. As I'm working out, I'm saying, Jam Yong Kensi Choki Lodro. Jam Yong Kensi Choki Lodro. Jam Yong Kensi Choki Lodro. I'm saying that mantra to myself, and it helps me just keep going. Helps me keep going. Keeps going. Keeps going. Says, "Come on, this is good motivation. This is if this, this is helpful for him." He's one of the greatest advocates for the good news and the Dharma that this world's ever had. Actually, he's one of the greatest. He's up there with the greatest. He really is. He's up there in very high echelon land, okay? Because he's actually done it. I mean, he actually did stuff that worked powerfully and empowered the Dharma tremendously, so that it's still nominally alive in the world through the Tibetan Buddhists, for instance, that austerity of practice and discipline and focus and conviction and confidence and compassion and everything they bring, you know, tremendous love for the guru, tremendous confidence for the in the lineage, feeling that this is the purpose of life. All that stuff is super, super helpful. It ultimately bears fruit. These are great habits. And this is what the New World Order wants to submerge. They want to get rid of it. They want us to have really bad habits. So these manias come along and these depressions come along. All this stuff is engineered. It's all socially engineered, this stuff. It doesn't happen on its own. Believe me, it does. It does. You have many, many operatives at work here in many, many facets throughout society with a lot of seed money. It's amazing. Funding various things, making things happen. You know, a certain place is made available, and then there's somehow the charismatic figures have enough money to do this stuff, and they don't get in trouble with the law, how does this happen? Because it's an operation that is taking place, a very sophisticated operation. They know their business, just like the Tibetan Buddhists know their business. The obstructionists know their business too, and they're very good at it. And they got a lot of money, and they do a lot of training, and they have a lot of plans, and they're very slick about it. Just like the 60s, most people don't even know what happened. Well, some of us have been piecing it back, looking back, and we're starting, you know, some people have done some really good work on this, and you realize it was an operation, actually. And most hippies don't want to believe that. They hate hearing that. It was an operation. You got operated on. To a certain extent. And the very fact that the world's in such trouble now points that out. Is that it wasn't, you know, it only went so far, and okay, so sure, hippies want to feel okay that their life was meaningful and wonderful and everything. Well, to a certain extent, but did you not get distracted? Did you lead the life you really wanted to lead, is the question. Are you on point right now? Do you realize there's only on point right now? So, and how is society right now? Okay, how is society right now? Was it really a great thing to break everything down, right? Was it really... Or could we have done it some other way, actually? Did we really have to get into all those drugs, all the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll? Was that really the best, in our best interest, and culture's best interest, and everybody's best interest, and all that? You know, was it really? The evidence would suggest otherwise. But there was some wisdom to the hippiness too. So it didn't, you know, it didn't, spirit always gives rise to wisdom. So you got to take the good from it. There's a lot of really, really good that came of the, what we called the counterculture. As long as we keep our balance and don't go too far this way or that way. So don't feel bad about yourself. Keep in mind that your entire life, one vision redeems your entire life. One insight settles it all. One insight does indeed settle it all. And I just experienced this today. Just one insight, I just saw it, and I said, ah, that completely redeems my whole life, not just this life, but all my lives, all karma, positive and negative, it's all redeemed with just one insight instantaneously like that. But like falling rose petals, gently. Everything's just gently falling, like a soft rose petal falling down into this, you know, it's into this redemption. Everything, all simultaneously redeemed. Your entire sojourn into believing in conventions is all redeemed simultaneously, right in the now. And this vision is absolutely possible. I just had it today. So in no way beat yourself up or have regrets about anything. Okay? Absolutely have no regrets about anything. Because it's all going to be redeemed for you at some point. Entirely. Entirely. Without anything being left out whatsoever. Not one even speck will be not redeemed. It will all be redeemed. Everything you've done, all the stupid stuff, all the, you know, whatever. I've done so much stupid stuff, it's ridiculous. My whole life's been stupid. So, but I saw it, it's all redeemed. Wow. And any tradition can experience this. It's just this insight. You don't have to stuff it into any labels, actually. I'm trying not to label it in any way. I'm just trying to break the ice here and make us aware that this absolutely will happen to you at some point, either this life or the next, whenever. Hopefully, you know, why not right now? You will see. Oh, wow, I see the mechanism of redemption. I see it's very, absolutely simple, this instant. I can choose redemption this very instant, any instant, and it is so. But don't try to grasp it, don't try to label it, don't try to stuff it into any tradition. Just full stop in the wow. I say full stop in the wow. I say, okay, let's see how I feel about this. Can I go forward and can I keep, you know, yeah, everything's fine. I feel normal. I don't know how I'm going to feel tomorrow with my legs. That was intense. That was intense. I wanted something that's kind of intense. It was intense. Because it was just shaking, whole body's just. But it feels pretty good to accomplish something like that. And it's okay. But don't let it, see, it hasn't detracted from my practicing. It hasn't detracted. So I'm still able to do this, so that's good. You need like a whole, your whole body needs to be stronger in order to do these workouts that are pretty intense. You know, you can't just rely on one part of your body being strong. It's everything. It's your whole core. It's your whole posture. It's just everything that carries you through. So it's a 360-degree sort of thing. And the spiritual situation we're in, it's also 360-degrees. So whatever you can focus on, the Holy Spirit gets your attention to. Take it in, wow it. Because you're going towards this vision of redemption. There's no question about it. I was just thinking and putting my full effort in, like I have every day, 24/7, and it just, I said, hey, why don't I look, can I look at it this way? Just something came up, like, look at this way. I said, because I was wondering about my life, the regrets of my life. I said, is there any other way I can look at this? How do I get rid of all these regrets that I have? And then I just simply saw it. I said, oh, it's all completely redeemed. Totally redeemed forever. I don't, this vision, I don't have a speck of regret. None. Vanished. All regrets vanished. How would you like that? Well, it's coming for you. It's coming for you, but you won't get it through depression or through mania. You won't get it by becoming a maniac. We're all maniacs here. Just believing that we're in this world, that we're seeing something that's not here, experiencing something that's not here right now, we're maniacs. Okay, we just admit we're all maniacs here. But if you see it, then you say, well, I don't want to act that out. Let me see if I can get free of being a maniac. Is there a vision of redemption? Yes, there is. Is there redemption? Yes, there is. So I'm saying this very, very confidently without trying to break it down and dissect it. I don't want to. Okay, it's important not to do that. Resist the temptation to dissect your experiencing, because where is your experiencing other than right here, right now? Dissecting into what? What part is in the future? What part is in the past? And none of it is. It's 100% here. It's 100% now. It's 100% authentic. What is there to dissect? Well, we got to feed the not now. Well, when are we experiencing the not now? Isn't the not now also being experienced now? Isn't it the chase for the not now? Isn't that also in the now? What is not in the now? What is not in the now? Let us ask that question. What is not in the now? So I'm trying to, you know, to keep pushing. We got, what, 12 more days to the 24th. 12, just 12 more days. Interesting, right? 12 more days. I'm not sure what the Holy Spirit. I just take it one step at a time and just, you know, what do you want me to do today? The workouts I do are pretty intense. Don't take very long. I don't really know if I have time to like spend like 4 hours, you know, hiking or something. I don't know. I got so much I have to do to try to help everyone out, you know, help myself out too here in sharing this. So I don't want to just go on a mania of like, you know, let me go hiking for long periods of time or something. I don't know. We'll see what the Holy Spirit says. So far, no. So my workouts actually, I do it very quick. I don't take that much time. Jump rope, I can do 100 in 1 minute, under a minute, actually. Do 100 and you spent 1 minute, okay? You say, oh yeah, working out, it takes so long. No, 1 minute to jump rope 100 times and you can do it in 1 minute easily. You know, chook, 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 chook. And just do 100 and then you walk away from it. And then get back to your taping, get back to your working with, you know, these reminders. Facebook is interesting. I'm using it more and more in terms of I'm posting more to my Take Satsang page, which supposedly those are supposed to show up on my timeline too. Well, and eventually it's weird, they don't always show up, or they show up later on or something, but they're supposed to. And I'm posting more and more and more stuff now, sharing. I'm just starting to share now more. I'm starting to figure that out, that you could share this. And you could really come stay immersed 24/7, you know, in but practicing is also super important. Like all day I was taping today while working, and then taping now. And so don't just Facebook it, okay? That's imbalanced. You have to go deeper. You have to really, and so many, I did so much affirmation and encouragement, you know, Nyingma masters and envision how I can help them, how I can be part of their lineage, how can I be part of what they've done, because they've done a fabulous job. They're pros, you know, okay, they're big leaguers. They're really, it's the big leagues. You know, when you talk about the big leagues, the Nyingma masters, that whole tradition, they're big leaguers, you know, and I've always wanted to be in the big leagues. Yeah, I just thought it would be in baseball, but it didn't turn out to be in baseball, so I worked to be in the big leagues of some tradition, or the, you know, spiritual tradition. They're very much big league, like the Yankees or something. You know, they're really, really extraordinary, extraordinarily professional. The Yankees in baseball were always considered to be these, you know, the very apex of professionalism and talent, and the Yankee way, you know, is just the crown jewel of baseball. And anyone who's you know, and the Yankees invite them to play. So you would like to come play for us? Oh my gosh, are you kidding? Can I keep up your standards? You know, that's my question. I mean, your standards are so high. I don't know. I don't want to pull them down, you know. And so, Nyingma masters and the Nyingma tradition, it's such a high tradition. You know, it's like, I'm thinking, you know, do they really want to add me? Am I pull it down, you know? Really, compared to them, they're world beaters, you know. But those are older times, too. And today, it may be quite something just to be, you know, doing what I'm doing may be pretty difficult. I mean, just in our contemporary time, right? But, yeah, they they didn't, there's 24/7 for them, for sure. They lived it, completely lived it. Maybe the most religious society we've ever had on earth. I mean, all their names are all have to do with the good news and Dharma that they name their children. It's amazing. Every name is just like Jamyang means the gentle voice, Manjushri. The gentle voice, Manjushri. Of the gentle Manjushri of the gentle voice, which is the great bodhisattva of wisdom. Dharmakaya wisdom, you might say, Manjushri. That's what Jamyang means. Which was a name given to him by his lama when he was initiated into a monk and head was shaven. They gave him this name, Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro. I'm not sure what Kyentse means. Choki Lodro, those have meanings too. Actually, but they all mean something to do with Tibetan Buddhism. All the names there, it's amazing. They're all positive, super positive. So every name they give a child is a super positive thing. Chandra, Sering Chodron, has something to do with long-lived religious devotion, very devout to the Dharma, long-lived devotion to the Dharma. It's along those lines. That's what it means, the name means. So just imagine naming your children in these ways that just completely connect them to the cultural religious practice. It's extraordinary. I mean, we have that here with, you know, a lot of people named after the apostles of Christianity. John, Luke, Mark, you know, Matt, Matthew, various, Paul, of course, Peter. So, you know, a lot of our names will link us to Jesus and Christianity here, but that's all going away. Now you got all these pagan names, you know, really bizarre, weird stuff. What is that linking you to? Yeah, the meanings. Just not, you know, it's not. I mean, it's amazing. Read the Tibetan, I should put that. I'll post that on the Facebook page. That link to that page. There's a, they give you these names. I just was looking at them. I said, wow. You know, the gem, the Vajra, you know, that which cuts through all delusion of samsara. You know, that's their name, and the one that flies the victory's banner, the one that flies the victory's, you know, the victor's banner. That's their name. And it's like, wow, how would you like to have those names? Well, that's so great, isn't it? Mine is a secular name. It means the one who has the capacity for great prominence, but it doesn't really tie it in directly to, you know, the Dharma, the good news. No. Sort of leaves it up in the air. But it is kind of ecumenical also. So I guess that's okay. Yeah. I can't put any prominence into any tradition, really. That's not my thing. It's better to be really ecumenical, I find. So, you don't feel pressure to shape your experiencing into a certain narrative, you know? You just let it be as it is. And then you let others also say, it's okay to just let it be as it is. You don't have to stuff it into any narrative. That's really helpful, super important. Jamyang was extremely ecumenical, also extremely ecumenical, and saw that this is, you know, the Dharma is going to the West, it's spreading throughout the world, it's not going to be the same, and he accepted it, you know, he's very much a pragmatist, ecumenical pragmatist, which is my cup of tea as well. But he experienced the world in its jewel-like, Vajra-like, intrinsic purity. He actually just literally experienced the world that way, constantly having these sublime visions wherever he went, whatever he did, was just these. Apparently he had visions and contact and empowerments with every prominent Tibetan Buddhist throughout history. I think he wrote an entire book on it, and that was only 2/5 of his life. And I think there's a book out, The Secret, talking about the secret empowerments and visions and everything, dreams and visions, empowerments, where basically he had contact with every Tibetan Buddhist there ever was, as far as those who, you know, were enlightened and etc. So he's like, wow. And just, well, he had a vision of every single Buddha of this age, all 1,023 or whatever it is, plus all their retinue, their devotees, they have names for them, and their those who are close in attendance and the disciples, devotees, and the whole thing. He literally clearly said saw all of them. So he had these visions of just seeing, you know, everything, just the threefold universe of all conventions, seeing all of that clearly. So he just lived in this visionary, empowering contact state all the time. So it's nothing for him to contact somebody. You know, that this is what he does. He was contacted his own life constantly. Wherever he went, everything he seemed to do, what was, you know, some other great. And then he wrote that it's all hallucination. You know, I never did anything. You know, well, that's so he's self-effacing almost to a fault, you might say. That's a tradition too. Is samaya is you don't try to stir up any mania about it. Okay, so Tibetans are very careful not to stir up any mania or depression over anything. So he downplays it to the most extreme extent. He says, no, I'm just a foolish, you know, no attainments. And I realized all the experiences I had there, they were just hallucinations of no benefit. And I'm just someone who's abiding in externally, I'm just full of the five poisons raging in my body. And internally, I'm just trapped by concepts and words and concepts. And so that's all I am. So, he doesn't, no mania, okay, because they understand this work is best done in the middle path without the depressions and the manias. And, of course, depressions and manias oscillate. You go from one to the other. So he doesn't want to whip up any frenzy around him, okay, that sort of thing. So there's a way to become aware without trying to go into some frenzy, some mania about it. So I have experience in this, a lot of experience, in how to kind of low-key it all, drive kind of slowly, and know when to hit the brakes, and but at the same time, you know, hey, speak up, let it be known. We're not going to go through the town with loudspeakers, you know, go-go girls, you know, and say, hey, you know, shouting at everybody, hey, look, you know, Eureka, Eureka, the good news is here. At least not right now, we won't. Right? Because you don't want to generate that mania. So, you know, they asked him to say something about it, his book or about himself, and, you know, he just said, I haven't done anything. Very dry kind of thing. I went, did this, just matter of fact, but I really didn't, you know, do anything at all. I'm just a, you know, moron and just stuck in all this, you know, delusion, and just all these experiences I have are just mere hallucinations, and there's nothing to them really. And it was just like, blah, you know, oh, God, wow, I'm nothing. So, and yet other times his writings, he would give this advice like, you could tell you just absolutely had everything in view. had it all in view. But you talk about somebody that can low-key it. You talk about someone's humble. He can afford to be humble. See, that's the thing. He can afford to say all this because he's got it all. He's got it all. So, you sure you could be humble when you got it all. Why not? Can't lose it. Nowhere to lose it to. How can you lose it? What do you lose the now to? Where do you lose now to? Where do you lose now to? Where can we lose now? How can it be lost? How can we be lost? Or is anyone lost? Where will we be lost? Where will we go to be lost? We're lost from the now. We're lost from now. We're lost from here. What experience are we having that isn't here now? Are we lost to that? How do we get lost to that? Or is it just a convention that we're following? I couldn't sing with the darn today. I don't know why. I never know. Well, I could sing harmony in the lower parts. I can always sing. I just can't like sing the way I want to sing. Hitting the higher parts real strong and everything. But yeah, just practice anyway. Breaking my voice from going up high to shifting into, you know, falsetto. And how to shift back and forth. There's a way to do that. It's a skill you can acquire. Where you can, so it doesn't sound like there's a break happening and your voice is smooth. I used to be able to do that pretty well. You know, if you really focus on it and practice the heck out of it, you can sound really good doing that. But, you know, I tend not to practice anything too much to try to become expert at it like that. You know, just say, well, you know, I know if I wanted to, I could become an expert at it, but I got something better to do right now than spend all my time on working on the break in my voice. You know, that's just sort of, you don't want to get fixated like that. So try to stay unfixated. This is where the great progress comes, is if you're unfixed, if you're focused on the edge of fixation but not getting fixated, then you really that go really fast that way. That yoga girl, you didn't stop. You never took any breaks. I'm like, I saw that, and I was like taking breaks and drinking water and stuff. I was like, wow, she never stops. What is this? So I started not stopping too. I said, maybe, you know, I wanted to see, is that possible? Yeah, it was possible. Yeah, but this is the thing, that there's great determination in our defenses. In our distractions, great determination, because we're trying to see what's not here, thinking that this is, we've created a separate reality. So don't underestimate the determination. Don't underestimate the cleverness. Don't underestimate the connections the yoga girls have, the financing they have, the capabilities they have to move around, to always seem to be, you know, in control and everything's going great. Yeah, it's an operation. And again, it's about ready to be sprung upon us. A mania is about to hit this world. This is my feeling. And there's nothing, you know, that manias have hit this world many, 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 many times. So many, many manias hit. Remember Disco? Wasn't that a mania? It absolutely was. Some movie came out, right? And somehow, discotheques opened up everywhere. I mean, how did that take? And many of them dispensing cocaine like and drugs like crazy. Studio was at 54. I mean, New York had these studios. There was who attended these studios? The yoga girls, the women, the yoga were yoga girls. They were fit. They were beautiful. They were rich, and they were, you know, fashionistas, and they helped spread this whole vibe. Like, this is what the beautiful people are doing, and you can do it too. Right? And before you know it, everybody on the street here in the suburbs where it's disco, wearing disco clothes, going to discotheques, drinking, taking drugs, running their ruining their lives, distracting themselves, losing austerity. Yeah, disco mania. And then you had the counter to that, was people try to get into hard rock and heavy depressive kind of music to try to stay away from the disco stuff. They hated it. I listening to it now, I like it. The music was it was great music. I a lot of stores play it now because it makes you feel kind of bouncy. Like I walk around the store, I dance around the store. And it makes you make me feel like dancing. Gonna dance the night away. I mean, it is great music, disco. It really had a groove to it, and you felt like dancing then. It really did. It was dance music. Great dance music, but it was very much a mania. It was just it swept the '60s away. It entirely did it not disco. It swept everything away. It was just like people like got upset. What happened to our rock and roll? It's gone. It's disco. Everything's disco. All the artists, went disco. Everyone went disco. Or even Stevie Wonder went disco. Everyone went disco. They had to stay to sell records. We're like, ah. God, I mean, it was like for us in the hippies in the '60s stuff. I mean, it was just like the worst thing ever, disco. Oh my God! I mean, we just hated it. The clothes, the polyester pantsuits, and the clothes. I mean, here we are, we're wearing our buckskin pants and our linen shirts and our beads and long hair, and going barefoot and, it just. And here are these slick, real slick, sleek pantsuit, with the high heels and the glossy lipstick and the big hair and they're just, dancing and taking it just like, oh. It just freaked us out. It absolutely freaked us out off us from the '60s. And I'm wearing my '60s attire right now. I've just got white shorts and a white T-shirt on. Just a white T-shirt, Hanes white T-shirt. That's it, and white shoes. It's the Beach Boys look, kind of this early '60s look, kind of thing. Actually, it's the early '60s. And so disco was the hairstyles too, with the grease in the hair and the grooming. Everyone was so groomed. They were all in roller skates, and hot pants and all this kind of, it was all glamour and we're trying to, Om Maharishi Om, and be the ascetic look and everything, and this disco came and it just put us in this depression. I got so depressed about it. The culture, the way the culture went, was so depressing. I just couldn't believe it. I said, it's just a nightmare. For a lot of people, I think if you've been through, if you went through that, and you didn't like the disco, what we're talking about here, it was hell. It was just hell. Because we felt the culture just vanished. People weren't interested in what our culture anymore. Like what? We're trying to get tune people to spiritual austerity, which is, a lot of the good stuff the hippies did. As I said, there's tremendous goodness the hippies did, helpfulness. It's try to tune us back into austerity. Very, very helpful. And of course the subversives tried to subvert the hippies, and they managed to turn it, here comes disco. That subversion pretty severely, didn't it? Yeah, it did. And the key is to keep this very positive, confident practicing going, no matter what's happening. So if disco breaks out, go with the flow a little bit. It wouldn't bother me one way or the other right now. Whatever music comes up, it's what it comes up. whatever it may be, even if it's rap or something, just don't get against anything. Don't be for anything. Don't be against anything. And you say, yeah, I could do that, but not right now. Yeah, I could go in that direction, but not right now. Don't be attached to anything lifestyle-wise. Don't be invested in that. Accept the lifestyle of austere practicing and keeping up some appearances and conventions here. But don't become radical. The radicalism is bound to arise going forward, or manias, radicalism. It's so out of balance right now. It's bound to arise. How could what we're doing right here arise when nobody's been practicing, when the whole thing's been termited? How can he have the wisdom to be like this? So it's bound to arise. The imbalance again is off the charts. People's minds are so imbalanced. This is going to play out in some fashion or another. There's no way around it, is there? So, of course, the one way around it is what we're doing here, and what those who engage in real, true, austere, serious, determined, desperately determined practice are doing. That's a way around it. We'll find the way around it. It's like I hit the brakes and didn't hit the deer. I didn't butt heads with the mania. You know, I was able to stop. But it's coming real soon. Real soon. Maybe even Trump mania is one of the manias that may be happening. I don't know. I'm not following it. I wouldn't be surprised, though. You don't want to get caught up in any mania at all. Even Jesus mania, you don't want to get caught up in it. You don't. This precludes your clear viewpoint of as it is-ness. It precludes it. It distracts you. It prevents this vision of redemption from you. It prevents you from experiencing it. This is what it does. Because you're trying for some certain outcomes. This prevents you the vision of redemption from taking place. It really does. And this is something that is present for you. You can choose at this instant, actually. You absolutely can. Nothing is preventing you from doing so, except distraction. And this feeling of momentum up to some sort of distraction, whether it's mania, depression, is very distractive, both of those. So you have to make decisions. And I decided, okay, you know, I'm not going to get on the Trump bandwagon, because I can see this could easily develop into a mania and a severe distraction. And no matter what, that's not helpful. No matter how charismatic the person is, it's not helpful. It's not helpful for a spiritual focus and ultimately the vision of redemption. It doesn't get you there. And you have to have that. Otherwise, you're driven by so many regrets. I don't care what anyone says. They're driven by regrets. And therefore, they're prone to, of course, these manias thinking, I've got to get rid of these regrets. Deep down inside us, we're all thinking, how do I get rid of my regrets? Because I know I've wasted my life. There's no question about it. I know I've been a fool. I know I've just bungled it. You know, I have so many regrets. I've distracted myself, etc. How do you get free of those regrets? And so we're trying to work our way free. No. Just one insight settles it all. Believe in that. It's true. One insight settles it all. And I, again, directly experienced this today. Directly. It was not just, it's not a verbal construct. It was an experience. I saw it, an experience. I said, oh, yeah, okay. Didn't try to grab a hold of it. I said, okay. It's there. No question about it. It's there. One insight settles it all. Every single regret vanished, not into bliss. No regrets left at all. Your whole life completely redeemed. All lives you've had completely redeemed 100%. And then you're free of the manias and the depressions and all that. You're not pursuing anything to get rid of regrets anymore. You're totally redeemed. one simple insight settles it all. This should be a very powerful mantra that I would suggest you start using and believing in that. I'm trying to help you believe in it because it's absolutely true. And I believed it. I've been using this mantra for just several days, actually. And what a result came from this, you see. One insight settles it all. And I practice like, one insight has indeed settled it all. One insight has indeed settled it all. Meaning, I'm practicing as if I've already experienced it. Well, just a couple of days after practicing that way, I have this experience that shows me indeed this is absolutely true. So to the small extent, it has already happened for me. It's already happened for me because I glimpsed it. Glimpsed it. And it's there to be seen. It is there to be seen. Very simple, very easy. Very simple, very easy. You just have to know how to look at it, what to shift your perspective in a certain way, and there it is. You see, everything is inherently already redeemed. You're already redeemed. Everything you think you've ever done is already redeemed entirely. It never was not redeemed. It was just convention to think otherwise. It was just convention to think otherwise. So one insight has indeed settled it all. Practice like this. When I was practicing that way, I realized it was a very profound practice, and I felt tremendous wow. But then this got me to the actual experience very quickly, within several days. I wasn't looking for any results. Don't look for results. Just practice. Results will come on their own. When they will come, they will just arise. Don't seek for results. Okay, trust it. Very important. When you start looking for results, you keep pulling the bandage off. You know, is it healing? Is it healing? Is it healing? Well, that's going to get in the way of the healing, right? So when we're always seeking for results, that gets in the way of the results. Very much so. So I try just not to anticipate any results at all. Just practice. One insight has indeed settled it all. And there's a tremendous amount of shaking that's involved with this, with practice, because it's really a profound shift of perspective. One of the most powerful practices that there could possibly be, actually, is this one. One insight has indeed settled it all. And believe that. Trust it and believe it. And I can encourage you now to practice in this way. Okay, but don't seek for any results, because then you'll try to put it in some mental concept perspective that it has to fit. This is my idea of what it's going to be like, and fit it into that. Stay away from that. You don't know. I don't know what it'll be like. I don't know, but I know that one insight has indeed solved it all. No question about it. No question about it. This is true. Don't try to formulate a imaginary conceptual picture of it all, of it. It will appear for you as it is. As it is. As it isness. As it isness. Now, we have teachers working for us that are so extraordinary. Two of the most extraordinary teachers. Three, you can put three, but if you include the Dharma Kings, how many do we have now? At least six. Six of the most extraordinary teachers that have ever been here, that are simply off the charts in every 360 degree off the chartness. But specifically, if you want to get really down to the nitty-gritty pragmatism, we have a teacher in Jamyang, Khyentse Choki Lodro, who is engaging with us, really engaging with us, who is so extraordinary that again, they say he may be the most accomplished of all Tibetan Buddhists, in terms of just the amount of sheer empowerments, et cetera, et cetera. So that's pretty extraordinary help, wouldn't you say? That was his, you know, that was his thing. He's an action guru, so that's his style. Now, I don't place him above, you know, any of the other Dharma Kings at all, not above Longchenpa, no. I say he's associate of Longchenpa, a colleague. I don't know, you know, exactly how it plays out, but Longchenpa certainly is the equal to any Dharma king, for sure, easily. Okay, is, but he may just be, you know, he's so almost mythical, the greatness of his status, such that it's almost easier to approach Kensei Choki Lodo. He's been here just recently, and he seems to have this, you know, we see his spiritual consort, Chanda Sering Chodron, and we see the pictures of him, and we see how he was, and he's kind of like so down to earth, you know, he's just so humble. And you know, it's just amazing. And we see that, we just say, wow. But we can kind of relate to him because he's sort of a contemporary, really, of us. He was alive when I was alive, so he's a contemporary of mine, actually. Passed away in 59, I believe. So I view him as a contemporary. You know, he really was. I was here for at least, you know, three years while he was here on this planet. Here, you know, he was, the body had a convention of appearance here. And so he's a contemporary, as is Sri Sri Ananda Maima. Those are two of the Dharma kings that are contemporaries. So I feel very much a closeness to them, those two. Ramana passed away, I think, in 1950. Longchenpa and Jesus and Padmasambhava, of course, you know, quite some time ago, so that they have sort of the status of a legendary sort of status sort of thing, that is, you know, throughout history, you know, so historical, where Ananda Maima and Jamyang Kensei Choki Lodro are contemporaries, and they walk the walk among us. I mean, there's a devotee on one of my friends on Facebook. I know that she spent a lot of time in Sri Sri Ananda Maima's presence, and just pictures of her there sitting with Sri Sri Ananda Maima, and we're in contact with her. I mean, she's posting on Facebook. This is extraordinary. You know, she was someone that hung, I think her parents were big devotees of her, and so she hung out with her a lot. That's really quite something. You know, you see what I'm saying, is that it's great to meet these people who were actually hanged out with our contemporaries, you know. It really is. It means a lot. And Sargadana Maharaj was a contemporary too, right? So this, you know, this is important. It's very important. And I feel kind of more at ease because we tend to feel more at ease with our contemporaries, right? So it's just, it seems easier. They kind of know, you know, what we've been through. Jamyang went through, you know, the Chinese Cultural Revolution. That came later because I think he passed away before that happened. But the communist Chinese, you know, coming into Tibet, the Cold War was going full blast, and you know, the nuclear tests were taking place. And, you know, modernism was coming, and all these various trends were trending, and he was aware of all this. So, you know, I feel he can relate to us. He can relate to us because he's aware of these trends, and was present when these trends were getting going. And, you know, lived through World War I and II. He was born in 1893, I think. So, you know, he is very much aware of the 20th century and his spiritual consort just passed away several years ago, I think, or something. So she's certainly very, very contemporary, very much as aware of all the trends of feminism and all that, and the modern trends of modern, you know, that we've been going through, very, very much aware of it. So I find that extremely reassuring and helpful. That they could keep the viewpoint of no viewpoint, even in the midst of all these trends. You know, it's very reassuring. That was death a convention? Yes, it is. 100%. Is aging? Yes, it is. Sickness? Yes. It's all convention. Totally. The whole belief in a universe is nothing but a convention, a mental convention. That's all it is. Believing that we're appearing in the universe is a convention. Believing it's nothing other than that. We're not really appearing in any universe at all. Never have. No, nothing's ever appeared in any universe. It's all a convention. Now we have this convention of going 2.5 hours. I don't know how this happens. I started. I said maybe I'm gonna try a little bit here. And I just like wow, I'm so enthused. I can't stop. It's a great time to be enthused. Remember jogging? It was a big mania, right? Super big mania. The marathons, jogging, I mean, that was a huge mania. President Clinton was in the White House, so jogging, you know, he was into all this, you know, stuff. And everybody was jogging and running, and I didn't do it. I didn't do it. A couple times I jogged a little bit for a couple weeks or something just to see, can I really do it? But I tend to just not do any of the fads. I just don't do any of it. Hardly any of it. But it's not easy because there's always something going on, many things going on, isn't there? There always is many fads going on. Sure there is. But what's coming soon could be the mother and father of all manias and fads, and it's going to break loose. At some point, right? You know it is going to break. You know it's going to break loose. We had the Star Wars fads and the tech fads, all the tech fads that came along. Are you kidding me? Computers and everything. That was just, you know, it's been raging out of control for so long. Went along with that probably too much, just so I could was aware of you know, all the basics and everything. And now I'm just trying to keep it as simple as possible. So. If you don't want to Facebook me, and you know, that's great, because Facebook can be a problem, there's no question. It's actually an addiction. I understand the addiction of Facebook now. It's really addictive. Oh, notification. Oh, notification. But it's really got nothing. It's just what you've liked. And so someone liked a picture you liked. You get your notification. Such and such liked a picture you liked, or commented on a picture you commented on, or such and such shared something on time. It has really nothing to do with you. Nobody's really interested in you on Facebook. I found out everyone's interested in themselves. Well, okay, that's fine. Yeah, as long as we get the good news out and the Dharma out. I'm interested in getting the good news out. So that's what I keep focusing on. Tomorrow's another day. Gotta get up again pretty early. Can't sleep in. Gotta work. So, gotta factor that in. It's already late here. But we're almost done. We're cruising here towards the end of the video, kind of. Yeah, whatever happened to the 3 hour and 40 minute videos? Oh, I miss those. Well, I could get those back by just having a completely white background, and then, or actually, I could turn up the exposure. That was like this, everything's just white, and that'll give like a super long video. But that's pretty tough. I mean, but I'm able to listen to 2.5 hour videos and do it. I'm able to do it. It's not that big of a problem. It's a good way to while away some time. Maybe you can look at Facebook as you do that, or maybe not. Maybe not look at Facebook as you do it. You can eat as you do it. Do stuff as you do it, as you listen to it. And I'm doing the best I can to just pump out, you know, pump it up. Pump it up. Pump up the volume. Pump it up. Yeah. Disco Mania and all the dancing that came out of that. Wow. The Bee Gees, remember that? Very talented band. say the least. But they helped drive the whole thing in a very, strong way. Yeah, it was, wow, what a freak out for the hippies. It's funny, we tried to freak out the world, but the world freaked us out. We thought we had freaked out the world, and then suddenly disco came along and freaked us out. We got really completely freaked out. The freaks got freaked out. That is for sure. Little cool down here. This one was not quite as intense as some of them. I'm frankly almost burned out. The intensity is so severe. I'm exhausted. My nerves are exhausted from the shock of the wow. But we got to get to this vision of redemption. It was very important to get to that. I would say super important. On the 11th of July, I got to the vision of redemption. Wow. Because now I know this is all legit. All this effort you put is really legit. You are redeemed. Everything you've ever done, it gets redeemed, completely redeemed, beautifully, gently redeemed, in the now, right now. Wow. Just consider that. Every regret you've ever had, including your name, your birth, your parents, your friends, your schooling, your lifestyle, your family, every last thing you have done is totally redeemed. All redeemed right now together, just as it is, just with no problems at all. Just like that. One insight just settles it all. Gently, like that. Just, that's it. That is absolutely true. Trust it is absolutely true. Vision of redemption. I haven't heard that term really used, vision of redemption, but that's what it is. This is what it is. Every last regret you could possibly have is just vanished, it's gone, gently gone. You see it falling into this field of grace, as it were. Like all turn in beautiful flower petals, and every one of these flower petals gently flutters down to the ground, and they just all the whole ground is just now carpeted with all these beautiful flowers, and they just remain there. It's like that. This is a way to kind of visualize it, if you want to visualize it. Imagine all these heavy regrets up in the air. There's horrible, ugly things are floating up in the air. All this pollution is floating in the sky, heavy, heavy sky of such heavy regrets. And then suddenly, all of them simultaneously turn into beautiful blossoms, flowers, beautiful flower blossoms and petals. And they all just softly flutter to the ground and come gently to rest on the ground. And wherever you look, it's just this gorgeous carpet of flowers and petals, and they're all just so beautiful and so fragrant, and they just remain there like that for you. And you're just in this beautiful state, a beautiful bliss. Just nothing but beauty now. Your whole existence has been completely redeemed into something completely sublime. Just like that. This is a way of visualizing it. This is what I experience, is just, this is what happened. Wow. All the regrets in my mind that are floating around in my mind just suddenly just turned into this softly falling, just gently of grace, so graceful, such a gracefulness. And then just coming to this beautiful, graceful rest in the now of this blissful now. It's just all redeemed, perfectly redeemed, like this. Don't despair at all. Every bit of despair you've ever had, every suffering you've ever had, every anxious moment redeemed, perfectly redeemed. Every bit of misery, every bit of sleeplessness. I thought my life was unredeemable. My life's been so hideous. I thought there's no way this life can be redeemed. I wanted to test it out maybe, and I see absolutely true, completely redeemed. Effortlessly redeemed in the now. Effortlessly redeemed as the now. It never was anything other than the now. I never experienced anything that wasn't here now. Okay, very great. We're about ready to conclude this video. End it on a beautiful high note here. Very great. Okay. Vision of redemption. Vision of redemption. Vision of redemption. It's going on longer. First time, it doesn't stop at four gigabytes. It keeps going. Isn't that amazing? It always stops at 4.0. It'll stop, though. This is really quite extraordinary. It never goes beyond 4.0. It's gone 4.02. This is a complete anomaly, folks. It's a complete anomaly here. It has never done this before. I don't know what to say. Maybe time has, as we've realized, there's no such thing as time. It's a convention. Time is nothing but a convention. Total convention. 4.03. This is really like, wow. What has happened here? We've gone through some barrier or something happened today. I don't know. I cannot explain it. Says disk space free. Disk use space. 124 gigabytes. That's not true. What is this? What's going on? I don't know what's going on. Well, I'm using a different memory chip, actually. One that says they say it's defective or something's wrong with it. I don't know what the heck's going on. Disk space. Anyway, it's still recording, I think, or has it ever recorded on the chip? It doesn't seem like it did. Oh my gosh, I have been recording this to the computer. That's why it's going differently. Now, let me see, what am I recording it to? Isn't that something? How did that happen? I don't know what it's being recorded to, where this is showing up on their computer. I don't know how I'm going to find out where this actually is. I better look at this. I don't see preferences where to find out where is this being recorded to on my hard drive, captured file, and big one. It's not saying where this is going to show up on the computer, so I might not be able to find it. Isn't this something? There's nothing that says Oh, advanced device settings. Let me click on this. See, this is really quite amazing how this happened. It won't show it. Okay. I don't know where this is. Where is this? This is. Wow. Okay. Very cool. Maybe I'll look over here. I don't know if I don't know what where this is going to. It's okay. I will have to find it somehow. Okay, let me stop the catcher and figure this out. This is or maybe just keep taping, right? Maybe we can just go. This is interesting to know. We can do it this way, if I know where it is being saved to. It could be anywhere on the computer, right? I don't know how to find this stuff. Okay, what do we do? Stop catcher. Very great. That's it. Hopefully, you get to see this.